All right, we are live on YouTube. Eric Van Horn here with Zach Butler and Josh Skolinek, and us three crazy guys been around each other for some years, a different experience in the franchising game, from franchise sales, franchisee, multi-brand, franchisor, and the list goes on. And we said, why don't we get together and just start a franchise with the three of us, and really more than just a franchise, it's the beginning of a franchise empire. But we don't have an empire today. We are at the grassroots of just starting out. And we thought, man, it would be fun, because we always get asked, all of us in the franchising world, everyone out there, if you're a franchisee, franchisor, small business owner thinking about franchising, there's no place to go to see how it actually works and how to get one started. And we are in the process of getting one started. So we figured we'd just go on to YouTube and Facebook Live and just share what we're doing. That's exactly it. So guys, what are you doing today? We're quarantined. We have nothing better to do but to talk about like what we're doing to start up this roofing franchise. So Zach, introduce yourself. Give us the 30 seconds on you, and Josh, if you could do the same.
Zach Butler, I reside in Omaha, Nebraska. I was a franchisee at 21 years old, had a huge rise, didn't really, and doing a lot of gross revenue with seven locations myself, didn't really understand the back end of franchising, ended up having the opportunity to partner with someone else. We had 68 locations across the country, all brick and mortar, got into franchise development, met Eric, met Josh, taken two brands from under 10 units to 200. And now we're on this call talking about starting a franchise from scratch the right way with the franchisees' success and profits at the forefront.
Like that.
Josh Skolnick, serial entrepreneur from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Started in business in my pre-teenage years, mowing lawns locally in a neighborhood where I grew up. Have an extensive background in franchising, founded Monster Tree Service in 2008 and began franchising in 2013. Currently operate over 200 franchise territories with that business. And in 2018, had an opportunity to acquire a controlling interest in a brand by the name of Redbox Plus, where we have about 175 franchise units. And Zach and I have both worked closely together on the development side, and Zach's played an instrumental role in the development and sales of a lot of those units in both those organizations. And, you know, for me, as an experienced veteran on the franchisor side, you know, my understanding has been a lot around, you know, what does it take to really make franchisees successful, and all of the traveling the three of us have done in the industry and networking that we've done, not only within franchising, but also just in the business world in general, we've learned a lot, and we've got so much to give and know what it takes to really be successful in business. And we want to help other people really realize the benefits of business ownership, but also want to make it as easy as possible and streamline. And, you know, with the depth of resources that we all have and the knowledge, we've got the ability to make that happen.
So we don't really have an agenda for any of these calls that we're doing. This is like, just go behind the scenes and what we're working on or what we have worked on, and the things that we're running into, challenges that we face, things that we're experiencing that we didn't even think we might experience. So if you have friends that you think would find something like this interesting, please share this Facebook group that we're creating, and share this on your own social media platforms. But let's go back to the beginning. Oh, I'll give a little bit on me. So I started a little bit older than Zach. I was in my mid-20s and got into franchising. Since then, I've owned about 7 or 8 different brands and in about as many states, multiple brands at the same time, been an area developer or regional developer, and with 3 or 4 different brands. And currently, I'm a franchisee, franchise consultant, help franchisors, advise franchisors on how to grow and scale their franchises, especially using digital marketing and messaging and story the right way to be able to get their message out. So anyway, guys, I remember when all of us have been a small business owner or a franchisee at some point where like it... So as we started to create this idea of what we're going to do, what I think is very different is it's really franchisee focused. Like as the filter of how we're making decisions, every decision is franchisee focus, right? Like, how is this going to impact the franchisee? And franchisee always comes up. And I think I still look at this as a franchisee, like, what would I want my franchisor to do if they knew like what was important to me as a franchisee? So Zach, any comments on that? Cause I mean, you're in the middle of it now, you're a franchisee and you've been a franchisee. So like, what kind of comments would you have around that being the filter of our decision-making?
So I look at it from two sides, I guess. The first side is a franchisee. And I remember being a franchisee, you know, 10 years ago, and as a franchisee today, thinking in my head, I just can't, like, why doesn't the franchisor do this? Because I would generate way more revenue, which gives them royalties. And it just, you can't fathom why they don't do this for customer acquisition, or like, why is this broken, or it's so easy to fix. And so that's from one avenue. I think that, you know, you and I have been on the franchisee side. That's frustrating. On the franchise development side, you know, you talk to franchisors almost weekly that say, I want to sell 200 units. And you ask, well, how's your franchisees performing now? And they just don't know. Mm-hmm. And it just shows that there is a gap in the industry where somebody can come in with the right focus, with the right knowledge and experience, and they can provide a huge benefit to somebody coming in.
Josh, you've been in franchising for a while as a franchisor. And I always tell people that I'm helping them look at franchise brands or advising a franchisor, like, a good franchisor has franchising experience. And so as much as I know about franchising, it comes from my angle as a franchisee, the same with Zach. I mean, we've been a part of companies, but we've never done it ourselves. And I think it's very different when you've done it yourself, and everyone has to learn somehow, but that's why, like, you're here. I mean, you are the guy in the group with franchisor experience, and we all lean on each other on different aspects as we're creating this new franchise in the roofing space. But like, we lean on you as someone that has franchisor experience. And like, what do you see, like, as you're creating this, what have you done in the past, and how might you be looking at this one a little bit different as we're starting to grow it?
Well, to dovetail on what Zach had started mentioning, it is all correct in the fact that when it comes to running a franchise organization, and I'll share openly, you know, you really have to, put a franchisee focus, you know, first focus mentality on things, because the franchisees truly are the heartbeat of your organization. And so, you know, as a franchisor, you know, there's, in the early stages of launching a franchise, there's a lot of moving parts, and there's a lot of, you know, I's to dot and T's to cross, and you just don't know what you don't know. And I'll openly admit, you know, early on when I launched my first franchise under Monster Tree Service, you know, I'm indebted long-term to those first 10 to 15 franchisees that took a risk on, you know, on myself and the organization, because they believed in the model. But at the end of the day, we didn't know what we didn't know. And we thought that we were transferring information as well as the confidence in that information to the franchisees in a strong way. And then you quickly learn as you're taking people with limited industry experience in the industry that you're in and the model that you're selling. And you really need to break that down and start almost from like an elementary style education and take them through every single step, because as we all know from personal experiences, you know, assuming is the worst thing you can do. And sometimes as a franchisor, you assume, hey, I've brought a very smart individual into my business, or I've brought someone that has a very diverse background in you know, their prior career to getting into business for themselves. So they're gonna be able to figure that piece out. We don't have to spend much time educating on some of the basic things. And you quickly realize you need to give them 110% of that information. You can't leave any steps of it out. And then you've got to be willing to, you know, really lead from what I call a servant style of leadership, and, you know, take the advice of people, because when you look at the power, the real power of a franchise system, it's not just the brand, it's not just the products or services that you're offering, it's the knowledge that everybody as a team can collectively come together and share information to really create, you know, very strong, you know, processes, ideas, just everything that's going on in the business. And I will say that, you know, some of the best ideas in both of my organizations currently have come from, you know, things that have stemmed from a franchisee just throwing out, hey, have we ever thought about doing this? Or do we try this type of marketing? Or maybe we should be reporting these types of numbers. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, the numbers are extremely important. And as Zach mentioned, you know, how many franchisors you talk to that they go, man, I want to sell, you know, 50 of these things in the next year, 100 of them, 200 of them. And, you know, you ask them, you know, what's your plan and how are your franchisees doing? And you sort of get just this blank glare from them, and they haven't invested the time to really dial into the unit economics of their business.
That's interesting. We're going to be talking about so much on different episodes, because I mean, we're at the point where we're probably going to start selling franchises in June. And so that's when we'll actually be able to help people that are interested to buy into this roofing franchise, roofing, siding, and gutters pretty much. But like, we just had an interesting conversation the other day in planning, but we're going to go in back to the beginning of the three of us knowing this is what we want to do, how we picked the brand that we picked, the partner that has industry experience, and we're going to get into all of that. Let's just on future episodes, and we're going to be, you know, doing a lot more of these. But what you just said is, I think the franchise landscape is changing, because we're right now, we're in the middle of Corona. Everybody is, you know, self-quarantined or mandatory quarantined at home. And so that's just the stage. We are probably, in some ways, it's the dumbest time to be spending money to start a franchise. But people like us, like, you know, we're ready to go, because we believe there are going to be people that are ready to buy into a service-based business, ready to take control of their own destiny and all of those things. And so I'm excited, because I think we're going to be getting the right franchisees that have that mentality that no matter what, they're going to make it work. And that goes into what we were talking about just the other day, when we had an offsite meeting planned where we had tickets booked, hotels booked, and then obviously that didn't happen. So we're getting really good at Zoom with the three of us and our other team members. But goes into how quickly do we grow? Set this up. The past probably X number of years, you name it, has been about franchisors growing really fast. And that's been the sign of success. How many have they sold? And then how many do they get to open up? And that's been, you look at it, all the trade magazines and everything out there, that's the benchmark, is how many have sold, how many are open. And we could go that route to get on those top charts. But in our conversations the other day, we're like, we know we're going to have learnings along the way. In other words, there's going to be mistakes that will probably be made, things that we'll be doing different, because that's how all franchises get to be great, because you're learning from your franchisees, like Josh was saying. So in terms of just our growth mindset, guys, like, as we can choose what path we want to go, super fast, bringing in a bunch of franchisees, or some type of, and we have disagreements in the group, like, hey, what do you think about this? And what do you think about that? So as you think about franchisee growth as a strategy, Josh, what's your opinion on that? Where's your head with that right now? Because you challenged me in something the other day on why we want to grow a little faster than me wanting to grow a little bit slower. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so it comes down to some very important things. Obviously, capital. Capital is extremely important. Growth, which capital is required in order to have growth, but then growth brings support. And, you know, when I look back over the run that I've had in both of my current brands, we've added some of the best support and brought on some of the highest caliber people to, you know, focus on franchisee success as we've gone through our biggest growth spurts. And so, you know, I always reference what many in franchising have heard as a slow death for those brands that are going to add a very small number of units on an annual basis, because you really do need to bring something like this to scale. And when you can do so, everyone wins. Bringing it to scale gets you deeper discounts on everything that you're doing, from equipment, products, services, just everything that you're using in your business. You become a big player, very similar to some of the conversations we've been having recently with various vendors that we'll be leveraging in our roofing business, and how excited they are and their ability to offer very deep discounts right out of the gate, as opposed to more of, you know, a here's where we'll start. And over time, as you prove yourselves, you know, we'll go ahead and, you know, decrease our price or increase the discount to you on the products you're buying. But most importantly, you know, when we look at, you know, the best path to go. I mean, for us, based on the knowledge, and this isn't necessarily going to apply to everybody else that's, you know, either an emerging franchise or looking to franchise their business, or an existing franchise company that even has grown to some scale. But based on the knowledge that we bring in our experience in franchising as a whole, you know, we're poised to be able to have explosive growth. And even though we use that word explosive, one of the things I always find myself talking about when I get asked that question, man, you've really grown a lot in the last, you know, 2 to 3 years, Josh, you know, what are you doing, you know, to keep pace with that? And I always remind people, as crazy as it sounds, the growth that I've experienced has actually been very controlled, because we've always kept the support well ahead of the growth that's been coming in, and really thinking, you know, typically 1 to 2 quarters ahead. So as we all talk about this launch, you know, in June of 2020 for our roofing business together, you know, we're actually already planning as a team, and the discussions we have are already into 2021. And we've got, as we put together org charts, and we're starting to really lay the pavement of what the future staff looks like, you know, beyond, you know, the 6 or 7 individuals that are already involved and the experts in the industry that we're bringing in. And in addition to partnering with John, you know, the, with the brand that we're getting behind, you know, in the roofing business, you know, we're so far ahead of what's happening today. And that's really what's keeping us, you know, poised to continue to maintain the growth that we're going to have.
So I was wanting to grow slower to bring in the best franchisees to have really strong franchisee growth. So the franchisor grows as a franchisee grows, but I was wanting really, really good franchisees so we can learn from them and help them and then slowly grow from there in some ways. And we're pretty much on the same wavelength as in terms of growth, but that's where you challenge me. Like, we need to have a certain level of growth to be able to help our franchisees get those deeper discounts and things like that. So it's just, you know, as we talk about all of this stuff, I think it's going to be important for us to look at the dynamics of our group, because we work really well together. There's no egos here. And except for Zach, when he's like hanging out with his cows, he's got a little bit of ego, but there's no ego here. And we're franchisee focused. And so we challenge each other. We don't want yes people around us. So Zach, what kind of comments did you have? Where was your mindset around that? Cause you're super franchisee focused.
Yeah. So I'll tell a quick story and then I'll come back. So I remember when Josh and I first started working together, we were out in Doylestown, and he's like, "Hey, you got to come see this new office that I just bought for Monster Train." And we're like, "Just bought it. We don't even have the presentations ready for development." And it's, "Oh, you got to meet this guy. His name's Tom. I just hired him for business development to help support future growth." I'm like, "You haven't even built the presentation yet." And I think when we looked back, you know, the development company that I was at prior, Josh was always the trademark. Hey, are they doing it like Josh is doing it? Are they investing in infrastructure and growth before that growth happens? So that way, even if you're selling lots of units, you're getting them open. And just because you get them open, are the revenue numbers continuing to be stronger every year? And Josh, that's, you know, that's where you had the vision to invest in that growth prior to us having it, which is, you know, one of the major parts of success. But I think there's two ways to look at it. And Josh, you kind of alluded to it, but obviously starting a franchise is still a business. So, you know, at some point the business has to be able to support the infrastructure with the royalty income. So I think you have to have, you want to grow to a faster point, but I think the way we're setting it up is we're going to have that data and be able to track franchisee performance on every level, benchmark it against bench individual franchisees against the system. And we're going to have that from day one, which is almost unheard of in franchising. So if we're having tremendous growth and all of a sudden we see sales are starting to dip down, I mean, we can pump the brakes, we can pause, fix our process, and then come back and keep growing. I think that's where we'll have it so dialed in. We can keep our finger on performance to where, even if growth is happening, as long as performance is consistent, I think you can keep growing at that pace.
And here's one of the things too, because as we were having this discussion, it was about franchisee growth and growing fast enough to be able to have the franchisor support the franchisees. That's really what Josh's point was. And it was a great point. And then we immediately started talking about training. How are we going to train them? And it's not just come and we'll train you for a week and thou go do your business. So it's growth combined with training. And if you just have just growth focus without actual training for franchisees, that's beyond just the initial training, then that's probably not really good growth. That's not what we're talking about with controlled growth. So as long as we have the team to be able to support the franchisees to grow how they're wanting to grow, so we're growing franchisees and they're growing all at the same rate, which is strong growth, then that's the right trajectory. I think as if it starts to get off where the franchisee growth is at bringing on a bunch of franchisees, but the franchisees growth in terms of happiness of that what they're doing or revenue numbers, if that starts to decrease, then we're doing something wrong as a franchisor. And so that's where we want to mitigate that and bring in good trainers to, and we talk about hands-on training. And as we were on that planning meeting, I was texting franchisees of other service-based brands and like, what are some of the best things that your great franchisor did for you? I got this big long list. And so it's not just us in this meeting room. We're supposed to be in Minneapolis at a cool place. And now it was on Zoom. It's not us just taking our ideas and thinking what we should do, but we take our ideas, bounce that off of other people that have maybe done it in a bigger way or more in the trenches than we have. So we can make sure that we are doing things the right way. But, and Josh is a big fan of that too, just that hands-on training, because, you know, we talked about all three of us, we know the importance that the best franchisees have other franchisees that come visit them. And now they become some of the best franchisee. So hands-on training, average franchisees hanging out in locations of the best franchisees. That's how the whole system gets better. Any comments, guys?
Yeah, I think you hit on some of it already, Eric, where, you know, there's so much value just even in the network of people we know, franchisees, of small, medium, and large scale and other systems. And one of the things that we often hear as we talk to other franchisees is that, man, I really wish my franchisor did X, Y, or Z, or this is what my franchisor implemented after, you know, we hit 100 franchisees or we hit 250. And truthfully, we believe that that would have been great if that was implemented very early on in the business. And, you know, and that's really what we're hitting now, because too many people, and Zach hit on a very important point, you know, starting a franchise is no different than starting a business. It is a business being a franchisor. And, you know, we've all heard the saying, you have to spend money to make money. And it's not just a good jingle that sounds good. It's the truth. You have to be willing to spend money to make money, invest in your business. But more importantly, when you look at the way you're launching this and all of the things that, you know, we're going to have our franchisees doing and we're doing as an organization early on, it's going to cost money. And we can't approach the launch of a business from a penny wise, dollar foolish standpoint. We need to really be dialed in, and we will find the right people to do business with us based on individuals that want to follow the outline. Nobody likes change. So what we're trying to do right up on the front end of everything with this venture together is have everything dialed in right at the start line, so that we're not starting and then, you know, repivoting in 6 months and 12 months and starting to introduce all kinds of new things to change all of the processes. We're going to have that very focused right out of the gate. And people that are going to be that type of individual or personality that has that type of focus are going to be the individuals we want to be working with, that are very decisive people. We want people that are able to make decisions, execute, live with the decisions they've made, but also have the ability to pivot without fear when it's necessary.
I think we should get into that deeper on another show, Josh, because that is something that we're still in the middle of too. We know the personality of that person. We know what we want them to have, but there's also, we're creating our ideal candidate, our ideal franchisee. What do they look like? Who are they? And it's not just, you know, what we think, but we're asking people that have been in this industry, some of the characteristics that they need to have. And so we've got to, you know, so we are even getting, you know, down to the level of where we will have an ideal candidate and we'll want them to come in to help grow this brand with us. The other thing, I mean, there's so many things that I think we should get into to just give every, I think on this next show, let's get into how, if somebody is a business owner and they're thinking about franchising, They got a couple different routes to go. They can come to a group like ours, which, you know, this is just one of several franchises that we're going to be taking somebody that has one or two or three locations. And we're going to, they're going to be better off with a group like us being, you know, partnering with them and acquiring the majority stake in that share. But now they get to be the expert in whatever business that is. And then they can continue to do that and be a part of a larger franchise. Or maybe people like that, that have a really good concept, want to franchise it themselves and hire people that have the franchising experience to come along. There's a couple different roads that people go down. So I think it's interesting. Franchisors will probably have questions why we're doing what we're doing. Franchisees will. And then we're going to have all these business owners out there that, like, people keep telling me I should start a I should franchise my business. And guys, I don't know where else they go. I don't know where else they're going to go to get this type of inside information as we're actually creating it. So anybody out there listening, if you see this on any of our Facebook feeds, let us know what questions you have, because we are literally going through this right now. We're in the beginning stages of this. We don't have a franchise to offer anybody right now. So we want this to be to add value to you as anybody watching or listening, or even friends of ours. So what kind of questions do you have? Put them in the comments. And guys, any last bits of wisdom or anything you want to share before Zach, you go wrestle some cows or Zach wrestle cows and Josh cut some wood, whatever you do.
Well, Eric, yeah, I'll say, Eric, I'll say,
go ahead, Josh.
You said none of us have any egos, but unfortunately, Zach usually holds a beef, you know, with all of us, because, you know, as Zach always says, he's got the best beef in franchising with Butler Cattle Company. So for anyone listening on the call that needs good beef too, Zach can ship you some of the best from the Midwest.
With ego.
Well, thanks for the plug. So I guess I do have something that I'm passionate about. There's a true network of franchising. And what I say true is that, like, when we're creating this, we brought somebody in from a competing industry that, that helped us, gave us free advice just because he appreciates our support. He's a friend. And so I think that there's, there's companies out there that will give you free advice, we would as well. So I think that's one thing that, we don't know everything. The franchisees at a lot of systems obviously have great experiences and knowledge, but I think that if you're in that position where you're starting a franchise, reach out and we can connect you with a lot of people. But I know Eric and Josh, there's so many people that we could reach out to with a text, said, "Hey, we need you." We just had a call where we brought in marketing companies to actually evaluate other marketing companies for free for us expecting nothing in return. So I think there's a true network of franchising within franchising that people are really there to help each other. And if you're not tapped into that network, you do lose a lot of valuable knowledge.
100%. Well said. All right. We'll share. We're going to create a Facebook group so we can start going live in the Facebook group. My main man, Michael, are you on? Are you there?
Where I am. Are you? Can you stop going live or no?
No, get on here. So Michael is my right-hand man, and he's going to be the guy kind of organizing all of this stuff. And so if you have, he might be responding to some questions and so, helping us with some future episodes. So, all right, we're going to sign off and get going.